It's really fantastic to see all these questions come up during the plenary, and I just want to encourage you to write them down and save them for the afternoon workshops, because we really want to pick up this outcomes-oriented, action-oriented discussion where we not only talk about historical or even contemporary context, but we talk about what we're going to do with that information. So hold on to your questions and, you know, tweak them and then bring them up in the afternoon. So it's my privilege to introduce someone with whom I have had the privilege of becoming friends during the past 2 years as we've worked together on two ARI conferences. I think there should be term limits, actually, for conference planning committees. But Frank Shi is a wonderful friend and a wonderful colleague. He is the former dean of students at the CUNY Law School. His training is in anthropology, and he is the best conference planning committee member you could ever want. So without further ado, I will introduce Frank, who will introduce Parag. Thank you.
Isn't Jen wonderful? She's the only one who on a daily basis fights for the Asian American studies in CUNY, aside from some members of our board members here, too. Jennifer is really out there. I want to, again, tell you how, like most of you, how I was so energized by the panel this morning. And though most of us are not prepared to take political leadership, we can contribute what we can, but we have invited people from the arts community, we have invited people from the literature community, from a community service, health and services community to come this afternoon and to put some flesh into the skeleton and to do some really work, big work for planning for the future. So save all your energy because there's much more to come, and I think you'll find this afternoon session much more, just as fascinating as you did this morning. So we found the committee came together and found a perfect speaker for today's luncheon. Parag Mehta is best known for being a constituency liaison of the Obama-Biden transition team to the Asian American Pacific Islanders and the lesbian, gay, and transgender and bi community. So he just finished his role as he had just led the confirmation hearings for Gary Locke, which went so well that most of us just kind of expected it was going to happen. But we should be proud that he led the final third cabinet member who's an Asian American in our president's cabinet. Before that, he was a director of external communications for the Democratic National Convention Committee. He was also the National Training Director for the Democratic National Committee. And he has been political almost all his adult life. He worked on Howard Dean's presidential campaign. But he started his political career as a policy analyst for the White House Initiative on Asian American and Pacific Islanders, initiative that President Clinton had put together. He was born in Massachusetts, but he grew up in Texas, in the weird town of, and he went to the school in the weird town of Austin. And he attended, where he got his BA, and he attended the Maxwell School at Syracuse University, where he received his master's in public administration. Again, to all of us at the committee, we're so happy and honored that you're here. Let's welcome Parag Mehta.
Thank you very much, Frank. Thank you to the organizers. I particularly want to thank Joyce, who has been, bird-dogging me since, I think, January 21st. The day after the inauguration, she got in touch with me and said, we're doing this, we want you to think about it. And so 5 months later, here we are. Well, it's an honor to be here today. I was really interested in listening to the panel earlier, and I was taking pretty furious notes on what you all were saying. So what I would like to do is, I have some things I want to talk about, But I'm going to try and limit my remarks because I'd like to have more of a discussion with all of you and use this time wisely so that I can go back to Washington and to the people that I work with and let them know what I heard and learned here today. The interesting thing about transition is that I feel like I've been doing transitions for the last 10 years. Everything is a transition, right? Transitions in jobs, transitions in administrations. And my role today is to be a transition between the morning panel and the afternoon working groups. So never let it be said that I stop working on what I'm told to do. I think it's interesting that the topic of this conference is redefining Asian America, because I'm not sure that we ever actually defined it. You know, when I first got the job that Frank mentioned, in 1999, President Clinton signed an executive order creating the first ever White House initiative on Asian Americans and Pacific Islanders. Now, let me tell you why this was so important. Previously, Jimmy Carter had done an initiative for black colleges and universities. Ronald Reagan had done one on tribal colleges and universities. George Bush Sr. had done one on Hispanic serving institutions. But each one of those minority initiatives were based in the Department of Education, and their sole focus was access to higher education for those communities. And in 1993, when President Clinton came to office, he had an inner circle of very good friends who were Asian American. Folks had come with him from Arkansas, folks he had known as governor, who came with him to Washington, D.C., and they kept pressing him on the importance of including AAPIs in his administration, including AAPIs in their policy agenda. And President Clinton said at the time, right, but what do Asian Americans need? Like, you know, you're the model minority. You guys are very successful. You're very well educated. You have great jobs and good income and strong family structures. You know, the government doesn't really see you as a community in need. And so these women, they were mostly women who were around the president, said, Mr. President, you know, there is need, but there's no way to know it because nobody counts it. You know, the census doesn't count us. The studies done by Health and Human Services and Education, they don't count us. So the step one is start counting us first, and then we'll be able to show you the needs. And so over the period of 6 years, they really started making an effort to start counting healthcare disparities, educational disparities, immigration violations, civil rights issues, really starting to put numbers to it. And by 1999, they were able to go to the president and say, we now have a strong case. Because it's one thing when you look at the API community as a whole, but when you start breaking us down by ethnic groups, by geography, by gender, and by age, you start seeing some clear areas where we are unserved or underserved. And President Clinton said, then you know what we need to do? We need to create an initiative, but not just in education or healthcare or labor. We need a federal-wide effort, a mandate from the White House that every cabinet agency will sit together at the highest levels and figure out how we include Asian Americans and Pacific Islanders in government, in civic participation, in political participation, and so on. And so they did. Now, when I got the job at the initiative, of course, I right away called my mom and dad and said, I'm working at the White House Initiative on Asian Americans and Pacific Islanders. And all they heard was White House. And so, like, oh, great, you're working for the president. That's fantastic. My parents were Republicans, so they weren't that excited. But they said that's great. So a couple weeks later, you know, they start seeing my, you know, my emails and my signature block. So finally my dad calls me and says, I got to ask you, what is this Asian American and Pacific Islander? You know, he'd never heard of this term. I said, well, you know, it's a legal construct, it's a political construct, whatever. You know, and it includes people from 50 different nations, from all the Pacific Islands and the territories. And he said, yeah, but we're not Asian. I mean, we're Indian, right? That's who we are. He's like, that's right. I said, Dad, where is India? You know, it's like saying Texas is not part of the United States, right? We're not the subcontinent, we're the continent. And so I said, well, Dad, there's a larger reality here, which is in numbers we're too small individually. But collectively, back then it was 13 million. I think today we're up to almost 17 million. You know, and I said that allows us leverage because the truth is we have a lot in common. So we spent a lot of time in those early years fighting over names, right? South Asians versus Indian American and Pakistani American, Bangladeshi American, or Asian American versus APA versus AAPI versus APIA. I can't tell you, like, I feel like, you know, we talk about immigration and civil rights and education and healthcare, but the biggest battles I feel like we have are over names, over how to call ourselves. And I think let's use today as a day of redefining. Let's move on from those battles to start talking about the things that are immediate and pressing and urgent and that are right in front of us. And so we sit here today in the middle of Asian Pacific American Heritage Month with a president who has a uniquely American story. and a uniquely Asian American story. You know, I've heard folks like Helen Zia and others refer to him as the first Asian American president, right? Because Barack Obama didn't just grow up in a white family, he grew up in an Indonesian family. He grew up in a family of Kansans. He grew up in a family of African Americans. He grew up surrounded by Asian Americans his entire life. When he was a student at Harvard, one roommate was Indian, one was Pakistani. He says he brokered the first peace negotiation between the two countries over what they would have for dinner every night. So I think part of, you know, what we have to think about in our construct of, you know, what is redefining Asian America, what is our agenda for going forward, I want to talk in two parts of this. The first is the political piece, and then I want to talk about policy. Now, on the political front, I was listening to the panel earlier talking about campaigns and the enormous energy. How many of you volunteered for a campaign this year? You know, whether it was the presidential, a local race, a congressional race, great. This is a good sign for us because we are now coming out of the shadows. We're not the invisible minority that they thought we were. We are really showing up and playing an important role in politics, and that role is being felt. You know, I heard the joke about, you know, going to Albany and meeting with interns. Let me tell you something. As a guy who used to be an intern, interns have a lot of access and a lot of power, and most of the work that gets done in Washington, D.C. is done by executive assistants and interns and schedulers. Those are the three people you want to be friends with. And I think what's important for our community, what really made me excited about the Obama campaign, was every state I went to, and I went to 49 out of the 50 in the last 4 years, just got to get Hawaii done. But every state I went to, I saw Asian Americans, young Asian Americans, working on the campaign, making phone calls, knocking on doors, serving in senior positions throughout the leadership, not just doing AAPI stuff, but doing stuff across the campaigns. And that bodes very well for us, because it's a huge change from where we were just 6 years ago. In 2002, I went home to Texas for a U.S. Senate race. Ron Kirk, an African-American and the former mayor of Dallas, was running for U.S. Senate in an open seat. And I went to go work on that campaign because it was historic. He was the right candidate. I believed in him tremendously, and it was my home state. And when I went there, you know, we did the typical campaign. We built a media operation in a field and knocked on doors and made phone calls and ran TV ads. And then, you know, 2 weeks before every campaign, that's when all the volunteers come flooding in, right? And the campaign manager told all the staff, you know, call your friends from around the country. Call everyone you know. It's all hands on deck. Bring everyone here. So there were about 10 of us who were Asian American staff, and what did we do? We called our parents because they're the first ones to come running when we need something, some help. So one of my colleagues is an Indian American woman. And her mother, who must have been in her 60s, shows up from Virginia. Now, this woman is what we would call in my community an auntie. Do you understand what I mean when I say an auntie? I mean, she's wearing her sari. She, you know, her English may not be perfect, but she's very feisty. They have the sharp elbows. You don't want to get in an auntie's way. They're very opinionated. And she shows up in my office, and I was the field director. So auntie comes up to me and says, all right, Parag, what am I going to do? And I said, oh, auntie, I couldn't think of anything to give her to do. I didn't want to put her on phones because I wasn't sure that she'd be able to, like, communicate effectively. I didn't want to, you know, have her staffing the principal because, you know, she was elderly. I thought she wouldn't be able to keep up. So I had the typical prejudice that we all had, right? So I said, auntie, why don't you do this? Here's some flyers. Go to the mall and just stand at the mall and hand out flyers to people. She comes back 2 hours later. All the flyers are gone. Okay, what do I do now? I mean, this woman was there to get work done. So I kept making up, like, busy work for her to do, you know, that was really inconsequential and wasn't going to help us, but I just wanted to get her out of the way. So finally, she figured this out. So on the third day, she shows up and she says, can you give me the phone book? I said, Andy, are you planning on driving somewhere? Because I assumed she was going to use a phone book to sit on. Because I was like, I'm not sure you have a driver's license, right? She says, just give me a phone book. So I gave her the Dallas phone book. And a couple hours later, one of my staff came to me and said, do you know what that lady's doing? I said, no. She's like, you just go check this out. So I walk over to a cubicle. She'd found an empty cubicle and a phone. She had gone through the phone book and found everybody with an Indian last name and was calling them and speaking to them in Hindi or in Punjabi or in Urdu. And she was explaining to them that she was this woman, an Indian American, who believed in Ron Kirk, who believed in his campaign. Her daughter was working for him, and she wanted you to get out and vote because it was important for our community to be heard. And in the course of the last 2 weeks of the campaign, she called almost every Indian person in the Dallas phone book. Now that is the power of organizing. And it was an important lesson for me because out of that campaign, I learned that one of the things we don't do in campaigns is create avenues for Asian Americans, for people of that generation to participate. And so as soon as that campaign ended, we lost, but I took heart because I'd learned something important, and I went back and worked on Howard Dean's presidential race. And the first thing I did when I got there in Vermont is I took the voter file, the list of all the registered voters in Iowa, New Hampshire, and all the early states, and I took all the last names of Asian Americans, all the typical last names we have. I called every Asian friend I have and said, give me the top 10 last names, you know, Chinese, Korean, Filipino. And I matched them against the voter file, and I pulled out a list of every Asian American voter. And I did the same thing with our volunteer database, and I called all those volunteers and emailed them and said, let's form a group, Asian Americans and Pacific Islanders for Dean. And that group turned into Asian Pacific Americans for Progress, which today is one of the most successful and largest political action committees in the Asian American community. So it was the idea of thinking beyond, thinking outside the box, thinking beyond what we were told, and working from the inside to take the tools and the resources that I had learned and that I had access to make them work for the Asian American community. I saw Hai here earlier. Where's Hai? Hai, where are you sitting? There you are. Hai was in Philadelphia for Barack Obama, and I want to tell this this sort of bookend story to what happened in 02 to what happened in 08. In 2008, in October, a month before the election, I went to Philadelphia, to Chinatown, because they were having this huge event there. How many of you were there? I think, Rocky, you were there, weren't you? There were a lot of Asian American leaders from around the country. Sam Yoon was there from Boston. They'd gathered in Chinatown for an unprecedented event. 3 weeks before the election, more than 100 business owners in Philadelphia Chinatown got together on a Saturday afternoon to collectively endorse Barack Obama for president. Now, let me tell you why this was important. Historically, business leaders in our community are the hardest ones to get politically active. And it makes sense, right? Because for them, what's in it for them? You put an Obama sign on your window or you publicly get out there for Obama, you could lose business. You might turn away Republicans. You know, they're in the business of making money, feeding their families, you know, being successful. And going out there, putting your neck on the line for a candidate is a very difficult thing to do. And never in the history of Philadelphia Chinatown had these business leaders agreed on anything, let alone politics. And on that day, because of the organizing work that Hai and the team of APIs for Obama did in Philadelphia over months and building relationships through the primaries, through the conventions, through the debates, brought all these leaders together. And it was the most amazing thing because I saw so many young generation organizers in the room, but the people doing the endorsements were the uncles and the aunties. And in broken English, with a translator standing right next to them to translate what they're saying, each one of them came up one after another to tell them why they were endorsing Barack Obama, why they were supporting this person. To me, that shows political growth from where we were 7 years ago to where we were this year. So what do we do with this? We have all this energy. We have all this enthusiasm. So many people got involved for the first time. Where do we move it? Well, that was my job in transition. The day after the election, I got a call from the Obama campaign asking if I wanted to come work on the transition team. And they said, originally they said, I was actually in New York that day, and they called and they said, we want you to do Asian American and Pacific Islander outreach. I said, easy, I know that community, I can do that, that's not a problem at all. Then the next day they called and said, we need to add lesbian, gay, bisexual, and transgender to your portfolio. I said, sure, why not, like, let's bring the gays along. Okay, so I'll do the gays. So then I got there on the first day, and they said, oh, Parag, we're adding two more things to your portfolio. We want you to be in charge of education and the arts. So I started looking at them saying, wait, you want me to do Asian Americans and education? You want me to do gay people and the arts? I mean, are there some stereotypes working here? But it's fine, because I care about education. I care about good art. You know, I'd like to say I'm a fun-loving Gaysian who's educated and likes the opera. So all those fit my stereotypes. So basically, I had 2.5 months to meet with as many leaders from these various constituencies to find out what your priorities were, what you cared about in terms of policy and in terms of presidential appointments. Those were really the two big things we were focused on. And I got to tell you, it was probably the hardest job I've had in my life because it's such a compressed time format. I tell people all the time that, you know, when the Constitution was written, inauguration was originally in March, which gave them 2 extra months to build a government. And it was only under FDR that we moved it to January. And I now realize that's a really bad idea, not just because it's freezing cold on January 20th, but also because we were very limited in how much we could get done in that very short period of time. And the truth was that when we started going into the federal agencies and we started assessing what was there waiting for us, it was a very bad picture. You know, under the Bush administration, a lot of things that we cared about in labor, in civil rights, in education, in healthcare, had really been stripped away, including my old office. The White House Initiative on Asian Americans and Pacific Islanders, which 10 years ago was created by Clinton to be this federal-wide initiative with huge priorities and a huge mandate, and the senior-most people in government working on it, had now become a shell organization with almost no staff, almost no budget, buried in the Department of Commerce with no one caring about it. And it was devastating because I felt like we had done so much work to build community capacity, to get the nonprofit organizations, you know, involved in government, to educate our leaders about our issues. And to see all of that sort of undone in 8 years was disappointing. But the hope that I had is that this time, as opposed to when I was in the Clinton administration, this time the structure was already ready for us on the outside. Because the national AAPI groups had already formed a coalition with their local affiliates, Organization of Chinese Americans, the Japanese American Citizens League, the National Consortium Korean American Service and Education Consortium, the Southeast Asia Resource and Action Center, the South Asian Americans Leading Together, all these big organizations, the National Coalition for APA Community Development, the Asian Pacific Islander American Health Forum, this whole alphabet soup, Asian American Legal Defense and Education Fund, had all come together. And they'd already done the work for us. They walked into our offices on day one, and they said, you don't need to reinvent the wheel. We've already done it. We didn't spend 8 years sitting quietly and waiting for this. We spent 8 years collecting data, doing the research, identifying the policy priorities, talking to the community, having the town hall meetings, getting the public input, building political coalitions. We've done all that work, and we've already identified our priorities. So that made my job very easy. Because I could go right away to my boss and say, these are the things we need to do right away. And there were some broad things on healthcare disparities, on immigration, on civil rights, on the census, that we're going to take a long discussion. And then there were some very specific things that we could do right away. And the one that I'm most proud of and that I want to talk about a little bit right now is the Filipino Veterans Bill. Now, most of you know that after World War II, the Filipinos who were enlisted in the American Army and who fought bravely alongside American soldiers were promised that they would get the same benefits that American soldiers got for fighting in World War II. And for 60 years, they waited, and they waited. And a generation started dying off without ever having that promise of their nation fulfilled to them. And for more than a decade, Asian American advocates, not just the Filipino community, but across the spectrum, have been going back to Congress again and again and again, saying, it's time. You have to fulfill this promise. You have to fulfill this promise. It's really not a whole lot of money. At the end of the day, it wasn't even about the dollars. It was symbolically, what hurt me is that this generation of veterans was dying off, never having seen that their country fulfilled its promise to them. That was really what got me. And so when we were in transition, you know, Filipino veterans was at the top of my list because we now had the Democratic majority in Congress that passed the bill. We needed the president to, like, give it the final, you know, authority to be in the omnibus spending bill and then sign the legislation. And we needed the president to tell Congress that he was wanting to do it. But the resistance we faced was the economic crisis, right? Because in times of crisis, what we tend to do is we deal with the urgent, but not always with the important. And to me, the Filipino Veterans Bill was both urgent and important. So my colleagues would say to me, Parag, we agree. You know, the president committed during the campaign to pass the Filipino Veterans Bill. He'd already made a pledge to do it. But this is not the time. Not right now. The first bill we have to do is the stimulus package. Then we have to do the budget. You know, we have to wait. We have to wait because there's these priorities. And my pitch back to them, with the support of the entire Asian American national leadership, was to say, no. You cannot wait, not one more bill, not one more month, not one more week, not one more day, because they have been waiting 60 years, and the president has promised to do this, and you can't stimulate the economy, you can't create a government without keeping the promises of the past. He's got to do this in the bill. And thanks to the work of interns and staffers and schedulers and community advocates on Capitol Hill, in Pelosi's office, in Senator Inouye's office, in Congressman Mike Honda's office, and to my colleagues who work at the White House, we were able to get, all of us Asian American staffers were able to get our bosses to say, okay, let's get it done. I mean, we basically annoyed them to the point where they're like, just put it in the bill and get out of our face. And that's how Filipino veterans finally get their benefits. I tell you that story because, you know, sometimes I think we focus so much on who's in leadership, who's elected to something, who's appointed to something. But I never want you to forget how important it is to have people like Hai working on the campaign staff, to have people like Carmela Clendenning working in Speaker Pelosi's office, to have people like Charmaine Manansala working in the Chicago headquarters of Obama, putting the Filipino veterans language in his platform during the campaign. The people who work in these levels, the people who really control access, those are the folks that we need to work with, and also we need to build more people into that. We need to promote more young people into working in government, in politics, and in campaigns. So that was the policy side of this. The other side, the side that really got the most attention, was the presidential appointments, right? So I was on a conference call about mid-November, right as we had gotten started. And we were starting to make some big appointments to the administration. We were naming cabinet secretaries and senior White House staff. So I was asked by a large Asian American group to speak on a conference call. And this was a group that was friendly to the Democratic Party, so I assumed that this conference call was going to be very nice and very cheerful. I was wrong. They laid into me right away. I gave like 5 minutes of remarks, and the first question came from the president of the organization. And he said, "Parag, President Clinton appointed one Asian American to his cabinet. President Bush appointed two Asian Americans to his cabinet. How many Asian Americans will President Obama appoint? And if it's not more than two, then we will be severely disappointed." Now, it's 2 weeks into the transition. We just won the campaign. I have no idea who's going to get appointed. So I said, I did my typical thing. I spun around it, right? I said, well, it's really about the quality of the candidates. We're looking at everybody. We're looking outside the box. I think that there are a lot of, you know, fantastic Asian American candidates that are going to be considered for positions, but I'm in no position to tell you right now. But I decided to make a larger point, which was this. During the Clinton administration, the rubric that we used, the motto was, we want a government that looks like America, right? A seat at the table. We want a government where the faces look like the faces of America. And I was very proud in the summer of 2000 when President Clinton nominated Secretary Norman Mineta to be the first Asian American in the cabinet and the Secretary of Commerce. Great. Huge moment for us. But what was also important is how many Asian Americans had been appointed throughout his administration. Then came President Bush, who kept Secretary Mineta a Democrat and made him the Secretary of Transportation, and then appointed Elaine Chao to be Secretary of Labor. And Bush actually beat Clinton's record in terms of Asian American appointments. Now, here's my hesitation with that. The standard should no longer be a government that looks like America. You know, that's an old standard. That's a 1960s standard. You know, back in the 60s, you were talking in the 70s in the census, you were talking about a seat at the table, Betty, right? A seat at the table. We just want to be counted. We just want to be included. We just want to be there. I think the standard for this administration has to be bigger than that. It's not just an administration that looks like America. It's an administration that sounds like America, that thinks like America, and that reflects America. To me, it's not enough that Asian Americans are in positions of leadership. They have to be Asian Americans who come from our communities, who understand our concerns. You know, the person who helped was the architect of the Patriot Act was an Asian American. I'm not so sure that that Asian American really benefited me and my family in any way. I'm not sure he reflected our perspective. You know, we've had a cabinet secretary who, I remember Elaine Chao telling a group of Asian American interns, keep your voices down. Be passive. You know, remember our culture and remember our heritage. I remember walking out of her office when she said that. And I told the interns afterwards, I was like, forget everything you just heard, right? I remember Bobby Jindal getting up as governor of Louisiana and talking about how we have to curb the rights of women to decide about their own health care and what choices to make about their bodies. That is not an Asian American value. Government intruding on people's privacy is not why my parents came to this country. So I think our standard has to be higher. I think our standard, not, it's not Democrat or Republican, our standard has to be that we need people in government. We need people at the decision-making table who know what we're going through, who have lived through our experiences, who relate to them, and who feel comfortable advocating for us. Because I'll tell you what, on September 11th, 2001, I was working in the administration, the Bush administration. And right away that night, we had heard stories coming out of New York and Arizona and other places about hate crimes against Asian Americans, against Arab Americans. And we immediately went to the president, we went to Secretary Chao, we went to Secretary Mineta, and we said, this is going on, you have to do something. And they said, you know, there's a lot else going on, this is not a priority. Except Secretary Mineta said, no, it is. And Secretary Mineta walked into the Oval Office and stood in front of President Bush and said, I lived through the internment camps. I remember the ghosts of 60 years ago. Not on my watch. Not on my watch. It's not going to happen again. We must quickly stand up and speak about this and stop the violence against Asian Americans and Arab Americans. That was the power of having somebody from our community who gets us standing in that room at that moment. It's not just about looking like us. It's about being one of us. And Secretary Mineta deserves a lot of credit because on the same day he brought every plane down in the country, he stood up to the president and said, we got to do this, and the president listened. So, well, if I had known then what I knew 2 months later, I would have said on that conference call, three, bitch, three, because that's how many we appointed to the administration, pardon my language. But I'm very proud of the fact that we not only appointed Asian Americans to the cabinet, three Asian Americans, but they're fantastic people. Secretary Stephen Chu at the Department of Energy, a Nobel laureate. And you know what I love about it? Having lived through the Wenho Li tragedy of 2000, when a Chinese-American nuclear scientist was scapegoated and racially profiled so publicly and horrendously by a Democratic administration, I love the fact that this time our Secretary of Energy, who's going to control all of our nuclear laboratories, is a Chinese American. I love the fact that on Pearl Harbor Day, December 7th, 2008, President Obama went on Meet the Press and announced that his Secretary of Veterans Affairs would be a Japanese-American named General Eric Shinseki, the guy who stood up to the Bush administration and told the truth about how many troops we'd need in Iraq. That's the kind of Veterans Affairs Secretary we need. And of course, I'm so proud of one of my favorite governors in the country, Governor Gary Locke, when he was nominated. Third time's the charm, you know? First it was Richardson, and then we had from New Hampshire, the Republican senator. His name is escaping me right now. But finally we got to the right choice for Commerce Secretary, right? When Governor Locke was nominated to be Secretary of Commerce, I thought it spoke so brilliantly to his resume. Because most people don't understand how broad the Department of Commerce is. You know, commerce controls everything. It controls the oceans, because you have the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration. It controls the time. They actually, the National Institute of Standards and Technology, they're the official timekeepers of the country. It controls commerce and business and trade in this country. It controls international trade. I mean, and nobody has a better resume and is better suited for this job than Gary Locke. Now, when Gary Locke got appointed in March, he called me that Sunday and said, Parag, it looks like I might be Secretary of Commerce. I said, yeah, I heard that. He said, I'm coming to D.C. and I need some help. Would you be willing to come help me with my confirmation hearings? I said, in a heartbeat. What do you need me to do? He said, I need you to help me figure out the politics of D.C. because I'm from the other Washington. And I don't know how things work there and I don't know the personalities, but I need you to show me how to do this. And I said, fine. So we went and we met with 29 senators on the committee. You know, he started thinking about his transition and his appointments. And we were having a conversation, I remember one day, where I said, you know, sir, you've got to start thinking about your senior staff. You know, you need a deputy secretary, you need a chief of staff. He said, well, Parag, I really, you know, during the campaign, I met so many talented Asian Americans, and I really want to bring them into commerce. I really want commerce to be, you know, a hub of talent and diversity, and I want them to come here for a little while, and I want them to move up and work in the White House and work in the private sector. I want to build a farm team. And so I think that's great, sir. I'm really excited that you want to do this. Let me just put on my political hat for a moment and talk about perception. Because if you start appointing a lot of Asian Americans to senior positions, your deputy secretary, your chief of staff, some people may look at that and say, well, that's a little too much. You have an Asian American secretary and an Asian American deputy and an Asian American chief of staff. And without missing a beat, Gary Locke looked at me and he said, Parag, when have they ever said that about a white secretary and a white deputy secretary and a white chief of staff, right? And right then I said, you know what, sir, you're down. You're good. We're gonna be fine together, right? Because I knew he got it. I knew that he was one of us, that he came from our community, that he represented us. So we've done a really good thing, I think, appointing three fantastic people, incredibly qualified, who are going to represent us well in positions that are not specific to the API community. They will be able to do a lot for us. They will be able to carry a lot of water for the issues that we're going to fight over in the next 4 years, in the next 8 years. And I think the key one that's coming up is census. You know, census is going to be a massive undertaking. More than 1.2 million people are going to be hired to be census takers. We want to make sure that those people come from our community, that they speak our languages, that they know our neighborhoods, that they know our culture. We want to make sure that in places where we have large populations, we're counted correctly, as Glenn talked about. This undercount is a big problem, because if you don't count us correctly, you can't deal with our issues. You can't even identify our issues until you count us first. And one of the big things that we fought for back in 2000 was don't just count Asian Americans and Pacific Islanders, but disaggregate the data. We need to know Vietnamese, we need to know Filipino, we need to know Korean, we need to know Chinese and Indian and Pakistani and Bangladeshi and so on and so forth. So that's going to be one of the benefits, is we already start from a place of advantage from where we were 10 years ago. But that said, it's a huge thing. Census is a snapshot. It's one day, April 1st, 2010, what does this country look like? All of this country, citizens and non-citizens, it's everybody. Who's here? What are they doing? What do they look like? What are their needs? So I think census is going to be, in terms of policy, one of our biggest things. And we can talk more about, you know, presidential appointments if you want. Obviously, I think most of you know that we have several senior White House staff who come from the API community. It's interesting to note, Barack Obama, when he was senator, both of his chiefs of staff in the Senate were Asian American. Pete Rouse, who was Japanese American and is now senior advisor to the president. Chris Liu, who is Chinese American and ran the transition process, was the executive director. He is now what's known as the cabinet secretary. He is the secretary of all the secretaries. He brings the entire cabinet together and runs that office in the White House. In the Office of Public Liaison, which is the outreach arm of the White House, we have Ms. Tina Chen from Chicago, who is very involved in the Chinese American Service League out there. She's the director there. And as I'm sure all of you have heard, our favorite Indian American actor, Cal Penn, is going to be handling the Asian American outreach portfolio. I talked to him a couple of weeks ago because it's my old portfolio. I've given it over to him. And I said, I'm coming to speak to these events. Are you ready for this? He said, I'm ready and I'm excited about it. I said, I got to ask you, like, what is making you leave movies to come do this work? And he said, I got to tell you, Parag, like, what happened with Cal, and a lot of people underestimate Cal because they're like, what, an actor? He's a really smart political person. He is an assistant professor at the University of Pennsylvania. He's focused a lot on Asian Americans in the media. He cares deeply about Asian American media issues. And during the campaign, when we were in Iowa back in 2007, there was a writer's strike going on. So all the TV shows and movies were shut down. So he had a little time on his hand, and he decided to go out and, you know, do a few rallies for Barack Obama, give a few speeches. And he got out to Iowa, and he fell in love with Iowa. And he started knocking on doors, and the next thing he knew, he was there for a month, you know, working as a field organizer like anybody else. And he just developed this passion for politics. And so the president said to him, Cal, you know, you're good at this. You should consider coming into work in government. And that's really the story of this administration. Regardless of what your background is, whether you're a social worker or a lawyer or working in the arts or literature, or if you're somebody who's a student, there's a place for everybody, whether it's working in government, working in community advocacy, or being a force to organize the grassroots that we built in the campaign to continue electing good progressive leaders who will fight for the issues that we care about. So I want to end with the talk about coalitions, because, you know, when Joyce told me about this conference, she said the first part of it is mapping boundaries. You know, what is our agenda? What are our priorities? And we've talked a little bit about that. But the second part of it is really the critical piece, which is building coalitions. Last night I was having dinner with a good friend of mine when I got to New York, and I was telling her about this speech and this conference, and I was talking about the importance of Asian Americans and civil rights. And she said, you know, do the African Americans and Latinos really consider us, you know, equal partners in the civil rights movement? I said, well, we're not waiting for an invitation, are we? Because if you go back and look at the footage of Dr. King at the March on Washington before he gave the I Have a Dream speech, notice that he's wearing a lei around his neck, which was brought to him by the delegation from Hawaii and California, right? Asian Americans have been a part of the civil rights movement from day one. You know, our history in this country, as I think Suki was trying to talk about, goes back all the way. The first Indian American came here in 1789. You know, we know that the Chinese Americans were here in the 1800s. We know that our trajectory in this country is a lot longer than others realize. But what I think we haven't done as well is we haven't told our story, and we haven't built those coalitions as strongly as we should have. We're starting to. When 9/11 happened, a week after 9/11, you know, with all the issues that were facing the Sikh community and the Arab community and the South Asian community, there was an effort by a lot of national API leaders to bring the community together to speak out about it. And I remember on that Friday after 9/11, we met at the Japanese American War Memorial in D.C., which is a memorial dedicated to the internment camps. And it was amazing to see the speakers. They were Japanese, they were Korean, they were Filipino, they were Thai, they were South Asian, they were East Asian. And they all stood there together, and Karen Narasaki from the Asian American Justice Center spoke. And she said that, you know, when the Japanese were put in the internment camps, nobody else wanted to speak for them. Not the Filipinos, not the Chinese, not the Koreans. When you saw harassment happening of Filipino healthcare workers, nobody else wanted to stand up for them. She said, haven't we finally learned our lesson that when one of us is down, we are all down, and we all have a responsibility to lift each other up? And so it was very heartening to see to me that that time, in that moment when my community was particularly in the target, that we were joined by our fellow Asian American brothers and sisters from across the spectrum. And I called my dad that night, and I said, remember a year ago you asked me what is AAPI? This is what AAPI is. This is what the power of a community is. This is what the power of joining forces is. We're not alone right now, Dad. We have supporters. So we started doing that pan-Asian identity. But what we need to start focusing on next is how do we build these bridges around common issues, issues of common purpose with Latinos, with African Americans, with Native Americans, with women, with gay and lesbian Americans. I'm going to suggest a couple of ideas, and then I'd like to hear yours. Immigration. The comprehensive immigration reform is coming. The president just said it last week. This is a priority. This is going to happen. We are getting the willpower together on Capitol Hill with members of Congress. But we need to start thinking about what is our agenda on immigration. you know, when we talk about immigration, we think about it differently than our Latino counterparts, right? For us, it tends to be a lot more about H-1B visas, about the backlog in visa processing, about the expense of the legal immigration route. I mean, you know, they say, well, go through the process legally and stand in line. Do they realize that the line is like 10 years, costs thousands of dollars, requires three attorneys? You know, it's ridiculous. I watched my entire, you know, family go through this. So we have an issue with just the process itself. And the number one thing I think for Asian Americans on immigration is family unification. The reason why I'm a Democrat and the reason why I believe in the Democratic Party is because when Robert Kennedy was Attorney General and opened the borders to mass immigration from Asia, the number one principle he made in there was you have to keep families together. We don't separate moms and dads from their kids. We don't separate brothers and sisters. We don't separate, you know, cousins. We don't separate uncles. We bring them together because it makes the community have a stake in staying in this country. When you can bring them over, you want to stay. And I'm the product of family unification. My uncle came to Mississippi and brought my dad. My dad brought my mom. My mom brought her mom. They brought their cousins. They brought their family, and then they begat us. So this is our history in this country. And we have to make sure that when immigration reform happens, that family unification is a centerpiece. You know who else cares about family unification? The gay, lesbian, bisexual, and transgender community. Because their families aren't defined. Because if you're a gay American and you have a partner who's not a citizen, there's no federal protections for you to bring him over. So here's an opportunity for us to work together. There's a bill in Congress right now, authored by Congressman Mike Honda, that brings family unification to the forefront. There was another bill by your New York Congressman, Jerry Nadler, that creates permanent partner language that allows same-sex couples to have the same rights as heterosexual couples. You know what Mike Honda did? He merged the two bills together. He said, if Asian Americans are going to fight this, let's bring our gay and lesbian brothers along with us. That's the way to build a coalition. I think on the census, we have an important area to work with our Hispanic colleagues because Latino Americans also need to disaggregate their data. We see the needs of El Salvadorians and Puerto Ricans and Colombians and Venezuelans different than the needs of Mexicans. So we need to work together to make sure that the data collection is done properly and that we don't have the undercount because they face that problem as well. With the African American community, healthcare. Minority disparities in healthcare hugely affect Asian Americans and African Americans. Why? Because when the National Institutes of Health does their studies and does their drug tests, they typically don't use people like us in the trials. Well, our physiology is different. We react differently to drugs than white Americans do. We have different healthcare interests. And so making sure that we partner with African Americans to advocate for the representation of our community in data collection, in research, in study, right? But also to make sure that when we do healthcare reform, which again, the president has promised to get done. When we do healthcare reform, you've got to create access for people who don't speak English properly, for people who have or limited English proficiency, for people who live in rural areas, for people who can't, don't have health insurance. This is an area where we have common issues and we can work together. Domestic violence. Domestic violence is an issue that plagues our community that we don't like to talk about because we kind of enjoy the model minority thing, and we don't want to air our dirty laundry in public. But domestic violence is a cancer on the Asian American community. Guess who else cares about this? The women's movement, the national women's organizations. This is a great opportunity to partner with our friends at the National Organization for Women, at Planned Parenthood, at NARAL, at Emily's List, all these organizations that are focused on women's health and women's issues. This is a place where we have something to work together on. These are just a few examples of ways we can build coalitions across constituencies. I told you that I was from Texas. And my political mentor when I first got started was a woman named Ann Richards. She was the governor of Texas when I was growing up. How many of you know who Ann Richards is? Okay. So you'll remember. Yeah, you can clap for Ann. Ann was an amazing person. Personality as big as Texas, which was almost as big as her hair. And I feel particularly, you know, close to Ann when I'm in New York because after she left the governor's, you know, office, she lived in New York for many years until her death a few years ago, and she loved New York. She fell in love with the city. She'd walk around the city and, you know, she just thought it was the most spectacular place in the world. But immediately after she lost her re-election in 1994, she went to teach a class at Brandeis University in Massachusetts. Now, my friend Josh was a freshman that year and sat in that class in the back row for an entire semester, the spring of 1995. And for a whole semester, he got to hear the wit and the wisdom of one of the smartest and the funniest and the sassiest women in Democratic politics. And on the last day of class, Governor Richards opened up the class and said, "You can ask me any question you want. Nothing is too personal. Nothing is too private. I'll take any question you have." So Josh, the little freshman in the back row, raised his hand and said, "Governor Richards, I have to ask you, what are you doing here? You know, you're the governor of Texas. It's the second largest state in the country. You gave one of the most famous speeches in the history of the Democratic National Convention. You're the belle of the Democratic Party. Why are you at Brandeis? And she said, you know what, Josh? Now, you have to remember, Brandeis is a predominantly Jewish university. You know, the majority of the student population is Jewish. And so Governor Richards said, Josh, when I was governor of Texas, I would look outside the window of my mansion. And every morning, somebody was out there protesting. Teachers for more pay, convicts for early parole, union workers for better organizing rights, gun owners for lower gun restrictions. But it was always the leaders of the Jewish community who were out there protesting for someone else, trying to give a voice to somebody else. And she said, when I saw this, I made a commitment to myself that whenever my life in politics ended, the first thing I would do is a mitzvah, a giving back to a community had given so much to my state. And that's why I'm here at Brandeis, and that's why I'm proud to teach this class. There's a lesson in there for us. You know, we spend a lot of time thinking about the issues that affect us personally, that affect our community. But you want to build power? You want to build leverage? Let's be a voice for the voiceless. Let's stand up for somebody else sometime. Let's join in partnership when it's someone else's issue. You know, when Al Sharpton's up there talking, let's stand with him, and then next time let's ask him to stand with us. If we do this smartly, and if we continue to promote young people and to promote people to run for office and to get involved and to consider that politics is a good place to be, it is a noble profession, it's a noble calling, there's no limit to what we can do. And that's how we redefine Asian America. Thank you. So should I just randomly pick? All right, let's try here. I am not going to run for president, but thank you for asking. You know, there's some of us who like to work behind the scenes, and I think there's a value to that. And right now, my priority is to get people elected who are good and who will do good work. You know, there's a saying that you campaign in poetry, but you govern in prose. You know, campaigns are fun. Campaigns are a place of ideas and energy and enthusiasm, and then you get to government, and it's like, oh my God, what have I gotten myself into? So I learned a long time ago that I'm a poet. And I belong in the campaign world, so I want to keep doing this. I like doing this. I like getting people elected. I know some folks have to leave, so I won't take it personally because I know there's another commitment.
Thank you. My question is about the federal case suffocating China's on Lower East Side about the Canal Street. Mm-hmm. Because this federal case, Republican, the law, you know, during the 80 years ago, because the Republican majority, Democrats cannot pass. But 4 years ago, when Bush won the second term, Democrat already majority, I don't know for why, Democrats didn't vote for this case. Now Chinatown has been suffocating and economic has been weakening every day because of since 9/11, getting worse.
Yeah.
So I've been talking with Jerry Nadler, even Senator Schumer, since there's some weakening, you know, I don't know why. She's so evasive about this job. I talked with also the Senator Gillibrand, came to China on New Year. Also, he said she promised to increase, but I don't see the answer.
Okay.
So can you guide us how to proceed?
Yeah. So I'm not going to be specifically to this issue, but I'm going to talk about what we can learn from this, because I know a little bit about what's happened with Chinatown. But I think the larger issue is leverage, right? Because if you have politicians saying to you, whether they're Democrats or Republicans, saying, oh, yes, we care about this issue, and oh, yes, we're going to do something, and then nothing happens, then the onus is still on you, because it's your community. With politicians, you have to hold their feet to the fire. You know, what I've learned after spending 8 years in D.C. is that politicians, they are risk-averse people because their number one priority is to get reelected, but they're also rapid adapters. They're people who, when change starts to happen, when they see movement, they want to be the first ones on the bandwagon, as I learned with the Filipino Veterans Bill. Once we got the momentum, once we got the right people, like Speaker Pelosi and Leader Reid, to start getting on the bandwagon for it, everybody else came along. So here's what I suggest you do with Chinatown. Number one is, if Senator Gillibrand has promised you that I'm going to work on this, you've got to follow up with her. You can't assume that one conversation, you know, is going to be the deal. I have so many people come to me and say, I spoke with so-and-so, I wrote a letter to so-and-so, I never got a response back. Well, you have to understand that, you know, we're all getting thousands and thousands. I mean, at the transition, we got a million letters, you know, a day. The volume of stuff we get is overwhelming. How do you make a difference? You make them know that there is a constituency behind this, that there are a lot of people who care about this, voters in their district. I guarantee you, Congressman Nadler, he sees 1,000 people standing outside of his office who are voters in his district, he's going to pay attention. I think the other thing you have to do is you have to start working with folks in who know the legislative process really well. This is why, you know, lobbyist is kind of a bad word these days. But there is a good element to lobbyists because lobbyists know what the priorities are for each member of Congress. They know what makes them tick. They know what their agenda is and what their issues are. And so finding somebody who can advocate on your behalf. The Filipino veterans had a great team of lobbyists who spend year after year bringing sponsors and bringing support on. So number one is you got to organize your community. You got to get enough people in Chinatown to say we're fed up with this. Number two is you got to figure out what is the avenue to get what you need. Do you need funding? Is that the number one thing? Can this funding come not through Congress, but can it come through the economic stimulus bill? You know, we just put $787 billion in economic stimulus. A lot of that money has not been allocated. Remember they kept saying we want shovel-ready projects? Are there shovel-ready projects in Chinatown that could solve some of this or that could alleviate the situation? Fine. Where has that money been given? Is it in the Department of Transportation? Is it in the Department of Commerce? Is it in Housing and Urban Development? Who do we know there? Who are our contacts there that we can go to and see if we can get some of this money funneled our way? You've got to first build the community support, then you've got to be strategic in thinking about where are the levers to pull. Is it in Congress? Is it in the administration? Where? And then you've got to figure out who can make the case for you. Because that's very clear. I think our number one failing as a community is not that we don't know our issues, it's not that we don't have an agenda, it's that we don't always know how to articulate it. We don't always know how to present it in the best possible way. You've got to make a compelling case that has urgency, that has a vision for what you want to do, and that allows people, everybody wants to save face. Nobody wants to look like the bad guy. You've got to make Senator Schumer and Congressman Nadler and Senator Gillibrand, let them get the credit for this. Because if they see a win-win in it for them, it's an easy one to do.
Thank you.
Yeah.
When I heard the press conference that Obama gave on the 100 days, he said that if someone, I think it was a black and a Latino community advocate, that, well, you know, there's 50% black unemployment. And his response was that, well, the things we're doing now to help the community, that will provide a taste in it and pick up all the people who are in need.
Mm-hmm.
So it seems to be saying to those of our communities of color that he was not going to address the inequities in diverse communities directly. He was going to let what he's doing for being the president of all the people, pushing programs that are going to address the whole country, but those will pick up and touch upon the needs in our diverse communities. Now, actually, what's happening is that for the Asian American arts community that I'm a part of, we just sent a delegation of people down to Washington yesterday, had a talk with some of the government departments in the Obama administration. That was a black, Latino, Native American, Asian coalition going down there to talk about the needs of the arts community. And that's why I'm here today. But just like the social service school,
mm-hmm.
which is here saying that 12% of the population, we're getting less than 1% of the contract, there's an inequity that's going back 20, 30 years
mm-hmm.
that we've experienced. I want to understand, what chance is there? Now, your first answer was that, okay, it's upon us to figure out how to go to the political community and get things done. But I think it's incumbent upon this president and this administration to let us know, what chances do we have that he's going to listen and address the inequities that we have suffered
mm-hmm.
for 30 years?
Yeah. Good question. So for those of you who couldn't hear that, the basic idea was, you know, we talked a lot about social services and funding, but also there's an inequity in the arts community where Asian American arts projects, museums, you know, our efforts tend to not get the kind of funding from the federal government that maybe other communities get. So I sort of have to go with the same answer, which is one, I wasn't really even aware of this issue. I did the arts portfolio. I didn't hear a lot about the inequities. So first job is we have to do a better job of educating one another because this is something that we need to know so that when we're at the table, give me statistics, give me numbers to say we are X percentage less funded in our programs than so-and-so. And then what are the worthwhile projects that we should be funding? I am a big believer in funding the arts, especially during an economic crisis. When we were in the transition and everybody was talking about, you know, Wall Street and about the stimulus bill, it was interesting that same Meet the Press, when President Obama announced General Shinseki, he talked about the arts. The last question he got on that interview, he was asked about the role of the arts in his administration. And he specifically said, he said, this is something that I don't want thrown under the rug. I believe that the arts are important to a healthy society, and particularly during an economic downturn, the government has a responsibility to promote the arts. You'll remember that the WPA was created during the Great Depression by Franklin Roosevelt in order to make sure that artists were not lost in the mix. It's easy to talk about shovel-ready projects, but when I lose my job, I'm not going to go get a job as a construction worker, right? But I could get a job if the federal government wanted to fund programs to support writers and to support artists and academics. So I agree with your principle, but what we had to do is we had to do a better job of educating ourselves. Now, the good thing that you have for you, and I hope that the group that went to Washington took some time to meet with the Smithsonian, because the Smithsonian has an entire office of APA programs that is really underfunded. I think that they actually should get better funding, and they've been working on that. It's one of the things they're going to ask from the new administration. But here's a great opportunity with an office that already exists in the federal government that's doing great work. There's an amazing exhibits, travel them around the country, created educational curricula around Asian American history. Partner with them and talk to them. Franklin Odo is the director. Talk to them about what projects you're doing, where you need the funding, where the need is, and let them go in with you. There's a huge power when you walk into the meeting, and it's not just the community, it's your partners in the federal government advocating for you as well. So use that opportunity as a venue.
Yeah, but I think that my question is, we are going down to Smithsonian, we are planning a talk and a presentation there, we know Franklin, but the question is that, is Obama going to continue as someone who's going to say, okay, he's going to address the entire nation, he's not going to take it upon himself to be the president of the black community, the president of the Latino community, and address the inequities that those that have been suffered down there.
I don't think the two are mutually exclusive. I think, first of all, you have to remember that he has a mandate. He has a mandate to be, he is the president of everybody. He's the president not just of the people who elected him, but of the 48% of people who voted for the other guy. So I think that's important, because remember what his message was during the campaign. You have to remember what he campaigned on, which was an end to the divisive politics of the past. Now, when he talked about that, he wasn't just talking about Republican versus Democrat. He was also talking about the divisive politics that we sometimes engage in out of sort of the 1960s civil rights mentality that we have. We're in a new generation. My generation doesn't think about, you know, inequities in that way. I understand that that's still very real. It's not any way saying that we're going to ignore disparities when it comes to healthcare, or education, or job creation. Absolutely, we have to be aware of them, we have to know the data, and we have to address them. But I think what he's trying to say is that he has sort of a responsibility as the president of everybody, that he's got to think broader. He's got to think about what are going to be the things that create jobs for everyone. What are the things that are going to lift every community up? This is not a mutually exclusive thing. You can still focus on disparities and inequities in minority communities and not give up the fact that you're also trying to help the country as a whole. Because here's the thing. We're all in trouble. We're all losing jobs. I saw this morning we lost 537,000 jobs last month. You know, those are not black jobs or Hispanic jobs or white jobs or Asian jobs. Those are American jobs. And the president has a responsibility to address it in that way and in that tone, because we've got to build confidence. You know, I heard Vincent Chin's name invoked in the earlier panel. Vincent Chin happened, think about when that happened, in 1981, at a time when the auto industry was collapsing, the economy was in trouble, outsourcing was a big concern, right, and all this talk about the Japanese taking American jobs. I worry about another Vincent Chin happening in this climate. And the way it happens is when you start having demagogue-like leaders who try and divide everything around race and ethnic lines, we're all suffering. It's not just an Asian American problem or a black problem or a Hispanic problem. We're all in trouble right now. And what this president offers us is an opportunity to rise together. He offers us not just the hope and inspiration of the campaign, but he says, we're in this together. And I'm going to be the president who brings us together across our issues and figures out how we can help as many people as possible. What we have to not do, you know, when we were in the Clinton administration, I had a cabinet secretary who used to say, we all fight for our piece of the pie. The Asians want their 2%, the Latinos want their 16%, the African Americans want their 9%. We need to stop doing that, because what that ends up doing is we end up fighting with our communities of color. We need to make the pie bigger. The pie has to be bigger. Otherwise, we're just fighting for crumbs. So we've got to, I appreciate your question, and I'm not disagreeing at all, that the president has made it very clear that disparities is not going to be, you know, something that's overlooked in his administration, whether it's in social issues or anything else. But I also want our language to change, because if we're going to build these coalitions, too much of the conversation today has been about us versus them. And the them too often is other communities of color, and that's dangerous for us, because we shouldn't engage in that battle. What we should be doing is trying to figure out, as your group that went to Washington, how do we come across boundaries and fight for common purpose. I'm just going to take another question because I want to make sure we have other comments, but we can talk more afterwards.
I'm Mike Millis. I am Public Relations Coordinator for the Greater Chinatown Community Association. I'm also Vice President of the Black Public Relations and Diversity Officer of the Black Public Relations Society in New York. And this is Kendra Lee, Executive Director of Greater Chinatown Community Association. And this whole idea of our two organizations working together came about because about a year ago in Brooklyn, especially where I'm from, there's always been this great tension between the African American and Asian communities in New York. And, you know, Kendra and I talked about this and determined quite succinctly that the concerns in my community and the concerns in the Asian community, they're actually exactly the same. There are some cultural nuances, but basically they're exactly the same. And there is so much more for us to gain working together than by continuing the schisms that have been perpetuated year after year after year. I just finished doing a workshop in public relations and marketing for the Asian American Federation. Why? Because they and their member organizations had determined that there were certain public relations and marketing initiatives that they needed to take, but they didn't have the person who could give them the instruction on how to do it. They asked me to do it. And why in the world would I say no? I've been talking about in various venues about multicultural collaboration and the power of multicultural collaboration, taking a note that no one organization got Barack Obama elected president. It was a multicultural collaboration of groups that got Barack Obama invited president. And I believe that if the power of multicultural collaboration could elect an African American to presidency, there is so much power and so much more that can be done following that same line.
I think it is important that when third people volunteer for different candidates, that they not be excluded because they're white, which I'm not, I'm Caucasian. This is white. And I am a Republican, but I did my best to get people to vote for President Obama. And if we keep saying you're this, that, or the other, and therefore we don't want you, that is cutting down the power of getting things accomplished that are important.
Absolutely. I completely agree with that. Back there.
So I think that one of the issues that we...
Stand up and speak up.
I feel like one of the issues that we've kind of been dancing around is the issue of class and class differences, because I feel like at the end of the day, doctors aren't talking with taxi drivers, you know, so what's a way that we can also, in addition to bringing in and building bridges with other people of color and, you know, like across political parties, how do we bring together all of, like, how do we cross these class differences?
So I think, I mean, these last two comments and questions sort of go together, which, right, is the idea that we don't exclude anybody, that we include everybody, that we make it a safe place for everybody to participate. One of the things that I think made the campaign so successful and then made the transition successful is that we started with, you know, a few set principles. Number one is that power flows from the bottom up. You don't have top-down organizations. And we have to be careful of that because I think as Asian American community groups, as we grow in power and financially and in strength, there's a tendency for us to emulate, you know, historically, you know, organizations from other communities that are very top-down. And that's not what works in this day and age. You know, the whole revolution of social networking and new media is that it allows power to come from ordinary Americans. The second thing is, on the campaign, we were really big sticklers about transparency. Everything we do is open to everyone. You know, we don't have closed-door meetings. We don't have private meetings. You know, during transition, people would say, well, can I have a private sit-down meeting with you? I said, there's no such thing. If I meet with anybody, if it's more than two people in a room talking, I have to post it on our website, who I met with, what we met about, and any documents that you submitted to me. That's the level of transparency that we put in there. Same thing with the campaign. We wanted our volunteers, the people who came to the campaign, whether they were Republicans or independents, regardless of their race or ethnicity or their age or their gender, we wanted them to know what our plan was. You know, too often in politics, we think that everything's a big secret, you know? And in fact, it's unfortunate because so few people understand the basic process of democracy. How do you register to vote? How do you become a delegate to the Democratic or Republican conventions? How do you join your local Democratic Party? There is a group of people who are invested in keeping these things a secret from you because they want to control power. And our campaign was all about sharing that information, putting it right out there. Here's our campaign plan. Here's what we're trying to do. Here's how we're going to do it. Do you want to be a part of it? Because we felt like whatever you lose in being transparent, you gain in getting people's trust. So I think that's the second piece. And then the third thing is respect, fundamental respect. You know, we treated people, whether they were high school students, whether they were taxi cab drivers or doctors or lawyers, it didn't matter if you contributed $10,000 to the campaign or $10 to the campaign. Everybody had an equal say at the table. Everybody had an equal place in participating in this campaign. That's very different from any campaign I've ever worked on. Because you walked in and you said, I'm committed, I want to use my talents to the best of my ability to help elect this person, then you had our respect. Then you had our full attention. The same is true of community organizing. You know, you have to let folks know. Now, some of it's comfort. It's going to take a while, right? It's going to take a while for the doctor to feel comfortable sitting with the taxi cab driver. But guess what? When you get them focused on issues, when you get them focused on what they share in common, that's how you solve that. That's how you solve the difference. And it's true inside constituencies and across constituencies. First, find what you have in common. Then find out how each person can use his or her talents to do something about it. The doctor will be able to tap into a different network than the taxi cab driver. But at the end of the day, you need both of them to accomplish what you're trying to accomplish. And you lay that out there for them, you keep it transparent, you keep it decentralized, and you let power flow from the bottom up. That's how it works. Thank you very much for your time. I really appreciate it.
Thank you. So it's a perfect segue into the next part of the afternoon. If you want to be part of this energy next year at this time, stay for this afternoon because we designed these afternoon workshops to really be workshops so we can all come together next year and really move this thing along.
Thanks very much, Frank. Okay, we're going to get together this afternoon and talk about how we can get ourselves some tanks. Okay, but before we do that, let's give Parag another hand of applause. Thank you so much, Parag. We're going to be talking a lot more. Thanks so much. Okay. This afternoon, we're going to break up into workshops, and then we will reconvene back here after those sessions to report out about the discussions. We want to hear what your perspective is, what action plans you think we can take to move the agendas that are developed in these sessions along. We will be reconvening each one of these workshop groups throughout the year so that we don't lose the momentum. We cannot lose the momentum that we've started here. Thank you very much.